It was my pleasure to welcome Ann Patchett to the Eudora Welty House in Jackson, Mississippi, to record the Welty Lecture. I want to tell you something about why having Ann deliver the lecture here was so meaningful. I'm Mary Alice Welty White, and Eudora was my aunt. The Welty House is a National Historic Landmark and one of the most intact literary house museums in the nation. Eudora lived and wrote here from 1925, when she was 16 years old, until she died in 2001. She left her house, thousands of pages of manuscripts and letters, and her photographs to the Mississippi Department of Archives and History. Today, the Welty Collection is studied by scholars worldwide. Ann Patchett wrote about visiting the Welty House in an essay for the National Trust for Historic Preservation. She created a beautiful description of the daring art and life of writing that took place here over the years. The Welty Lecture was recorded with the crew in the living room and Ann standing in the doorway to the dining room. Those two rooms, especially reminiscent of family, were very significant to Eudora. The living room was where she entertained guests and where visitors could see how important books were to her. As Ann said in her essay, books are stacked on chairs and sofas and tabletops, and they still are, just as Eudora left them. And in the dining room, family members and friends gathered for food and fellowship. Later, the table would be covered with manuscripts cut and penned and glued back together. Eudora's editing process. She never used a computer. Ann noted that bookshelves crawl along every wall in every room, which is evident in the sitting room, also called the cool room, because it had the only air conditioner in the house. Upstairs, there are more books in a bedroom, including Eudora's favorite murder mysteries and her mother Chestina's complete set of Charles Dickens. On the sleeping porch are translations of Eudora's works into more than 40 languages. From here, too, is a view of the garden, lovingly planted and tended by Eudora and her mother. Ann spent some moments in the bedroom and study where Eudora slept and wrote. Eudora kept photos and books by many of her author friends nearby. On her writing desk are notes and ideas for stories. Her typewriter was always close at hand. The closets and chest of drawers here were full not of clothes, but of letters and manuscripts. So was the secretary, which is similar to the one described in The Optimist's Daughter, for which Eudora received the Pulitzer Prize. As Ann leaves this exceptional room, she is greeted by Holmes Adams, chairman of the Eudora Welty Foundation Board, who will introduce her to begin the lecture.
On behalf of the Folger Shakespeare Library and on behalf of the Eudora Welty Foundation, I welcome you to the Eudora Welty Lecture. My name is Holmes Adams. I have the privilege of serving as chairman of the board of the Eudora Welty Foundation and of its National Advisory Board. The Welty Foundation's mission is to preserve the literary legacy of Eudora Welty, and through events like this lecture, to encourage both writers and readers of good literature. The Eudora Welty Lecture is a collaborative enterprise of the Welty Foundation and the Folger Shakespeare Library. The lecture is made possible by generous contributions by Martha Dowd Dalrymple in memory of her mother, Adine Wallace Dalrymple, and her grandmother, Adine Lambton Wallace, and also by the family of Eudora Welty in her memory. In 1983, Harvard University invited Eudora Welty to give the William E. Massey Lecture. Her three lectures were collected as a volume of essays entitled One Writer's Beginning. Published by Harvard University Press, one writer's beginnings was on the New York Times bestseller list for almost a year. The book was republished this past year with an introduction by Natasha Trethewey. One Writer's Beginnings details the inescapable bond between Eudora's childhood and her later career as a writer, and describes how her early experiences contributed to her distinctive literary voice. Welty's novels include The Robber Bridegroom, later adapted as a Tony Award-winning musical for Broadway, Delta Wedding, and The Optimist's Daughter, for which she was awarded the Pulitzer Prize. Eudora was a master of the short story. Her collected stories, which won the National Book Award at its first publication, was republished in 2019 with an introduction by Ann Patchett. Miss Welty received more than 30 honorary doctorates from universities across our nation. She was also awarded the French Legion of Honor and the Presidential Medal of Freedom. The Eudora Welty Foundation and the Folger Shakespeare Library decided to collaborate to ask other writers of significance to speak in their own words about their beginnings as writers and what formed their individual literary voices. But for the pandemic of last year, the Welty Lecture is an annual event. Our inaugural lecturer was Salman Rushdie, followed by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, Richard Ford, and Jasmine Ward. It is my pleasure to introduce this year's lecturer, Ann Patchett. Ann Patchett is the imaginative genius behind a large body of work. Her 8 novels have won prizes and rave reviews. Among them are The Patron Saint of Liars, Bel Canto, Commonwealth, and her most recent novel, The Dutch House. With clear, direct writing, she has transported us readers from the Amazon jungle to a gala hostage-taking in South America, from a rural Kentucky home for unwed mothers, and to a house outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. All the while, illuminating the human condition with her stories of people in these far-flung places and circumstances. She has written a trove of nonfiction, notably Truth and Beauty, about her close friendship with a fellow writer, and Story of a Happy Marriage, a collection of essays examining the theme of commitment. Her stories and articles have appeared in The New Yorker, Harper's, and The New York Times Magazine. She's even published 2 children's books in recent years. A graduate of Sarah Lawrence College and the Iowa Writers' Workshop, she has been the recipient of numerous awards and fellowships, among them a Guggenheim Fellowship, England's Orange Prize, and a Penn Faulkner Award. She is as well a business person. When the last surviving bookstore closed in her home city of Nashville, she stepped up to open Parnassus Books. She is a tenacious advocate for independent bookstores, promoting books and booksellers. Time magazine named her one of the 100 most influential people in the world. Her works have been translated into more than 30 languages. She is a former member of the Welty Foundation's National Advisory Board and a dear friend. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to present Ann Patchett.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Nice to have you.
I'm so glad to be here, and I'm so glad to be at the Welty House today. And I'm looking forward to giving my speech, The Nightstand. Every year, when friends ask me what I'm going to do on my birthday, I tell them that I'm going to answer the phone. The phone rings all day on my birthday. Good wishes, good cheer, problems I'm lucky to have. This year, Sparky decided to celebrate by running out the front door while I was getting the mail. He came back minutes later with something sticky on his shoulder and reeking of death. I lathered him up in the tub while the phone rang. It was ringing again when I finished drying him off. I ran back into the bedroom and grabbed the handset without looking at caller ID. A young man's voice asked to speak to Anne Elizabeth Patchett. This is she. I said, thinking it could be someone trying to deliver flowers. It was my birthday, after all, 57. My mother found a letter in her nightstand from the Veterans of Foreign Wars, he began. The Voice of Democracy program, it was an award. This piece of news was followed by silence, as if he were waiting for me to jump in. Okay, I said finally. No one sending flowers would use my middle name. The letter was about an award. I'm not sure why you're calling, I said. I've been trying to find Anne Elizabeth Patchett. You found her. I sat down on the bed in the early dark of winter, wondering if this was the beginning of a complicated phone scam. Did you win an award from the Veterans of Foreign Wars in 1980? It wasn't the sort of thing that would have come to immediately to mind in 2020, but yes, in fact, I had. When I was a junior in high school, I didn't understand what that had to do with his mother's bedroom furniture. She bought the nightstand at an estate sale. I took out the drawers to clean it. I found the papers, some poetry. There's a picture of a cheer squad. My papers were in her nightstand. That would be a picture of Tavia, not me. I tried out for the cheerleading team and I didn't make it. I won the essay competition. I'm still not sure what you're trying to tell me. I've been looking for you so I could give these papers back. The letter from the VFW, that's important. Winning that award is a very big deal. I wondered if such awards still existed. How did you get my phone number? Whitepages.com, he said. My phone number was unlisted, or it was supposed to be. You must really want these, he said. I mean, I know it must be exciting for you. You're nice to go to all this trouble, but no, I don't want them back. You can throw them away. Had he found them in my own nightstand, that's what I would have done. I can't throw this away. It's a big deal. In the background, I could hear a baby fussing, and then a young woman's voice came out of somewhere nearby. You won! Was I on speakerphone? I wrote an essay in high school. I think it was $100. That's it. I was a person who entered contests, working off the theory that you have to play to win. From the Veterans of Foreign Wars, he said. It changed your life. I promise you, it didn't. Maybe you don't remember. This is a strange question, but I have to ask. Do you know who I am? No, ma'am, the voice said. I'm a writer. Sparky was running around the bedroom. A bath always seemed to turn the key of his small dog engine. I am a pretty successful novelist. You're Anne Patchett? He let out a small cry, and then the woman who was in the room with him did the same thing. They whooped as if they'd won something big. Oh my God, I didn't think you were gonna be her. I am totally fangirling right now, he said. I was starting to feel like it was a scam again. It would make complete sense if you'd never heard of me, but it makes no sense that you didn't think that Anne Elizabeth Patchett wasn't gonna turn out to be Anne Patchett. A middle name is a very thin disguise. There are lots of Anne Elizabeth Patchetts, he said defensively. There aren't. He ignored my point. You have to have these papers. This is the start of your whole career. We went around on this point again. He wanted me to know he wasn't the kind of person who would sell what was in his possession on eBay. No one exists who would buy those things on eBay, I said, and if they do, I don't want to think about it. I told him he could either mail me the papers or he could throw them away. I'll mail them to you, he said, disappointed. He had made a movie of this phone call in his head. And in that movie, I am speechless, bowled over by the wonder of being reunited with the paperwork of my youth. He kept giving me additional opportunities to live up to his expectations. are you? I asked. Where are you? He told me his name was Damien. He was calling from War Trace, Tennessee. I gave him my home address. Should I have given him my home address? Then, because I was feeling bad about my stunning lack of gratitude, I told him it was my birthday. We'd been on the phone long enough for me to know how much he'd like that. Your birthday, he said, and the woman in the room with him cried, "Happy birthday!" while the baby kept up its patter. It was the gift he had been hoping for. Proof of our kismet. I can't believe I called you today, on your birthday. This is the most incredible thing ever. For whatever reason, the VFW essay was clear in my mind. When pledging allegiance to the flag at the beginning of each school day, we must discipline ourselves to consider the privileges and freedoms afforded to us by the veterans of foreign wars. We must never run through the Declaration of Citizenship by rote as if brushing our teeth. I feel certain it was that teeth-brushing comparison that secured my win. I'd written the essay without a flicker of patriotism, and all the craven calculation of a 15-year-old girl wanting to lay claim to $100. I take no pride in this. Not only did I not want to see the letter again, I didn't particularly want to think about it. I was, however, plenty curious as to how the letter wound up in Damien's mother's nightstand in War Trace, a dot of a town an hour and a half from Nashville. Here's my theory. I was a kid who stuffed whatever papers and trinkets I had into five shallow drawers of a small chest beside my bed. Those drawers remained so perpetually overfull that I had to yank them in order to get one to open. It stands to reason a letter informing me of my win, along with a handful of poems and my best friend's picture, could have slid out the back of one of the drawers and then fallen behind the others. My mother and stepfather moved while I was away at college, at which point I lost my designated bedroom. My grandmother moved into the new house with them, and my nightstands took up their posts on either side of her bed. When I went to graduate school and had to furnish my first apartment, I wasn't about to take my nightstands away from my grandmother. Instead, I went to the cavernous basement, a veritable furniture showroom, and took my grandmother's old nightstands, the one she'd grown tired of after so many years. These nightstands, which I remembered so clearly from childhood, were old-fashioned, tall and narrow, with a small drawer on top and two roomier drawers underneath. They had come into our family by way of my grandfather's first wife, Frances, who had died of a brain tumor in the early 1930s. My grandmother and my nightstands lived together in my mother's house for the next 17 years. From there, they moved to assisted living and finally to that facility's memory care unit. I was in that unit, lying in my grandmother's bed with her when she died. She owned so few things at the end of her life, and when she was gone, my mother and sister and I each took what we wanted. None of us wanted the nightstands, and so we left them. A letter announcing my win for a high school essay competition, some poetry, and Tavia's cheerleading picture still wedged behind the drawers where they had fallen all those years before. I was 41 when my grandmother died. I cannot tell you where those tables spent the next 16 years or if they remained a set. It hadn't occurred to me to ask Damien if his mother had bought one nightstand or two. What unsettled me about the story was not the singular strangeness of it, but that it kept happening. Several months before, the Librarian of Congress had contacted me, wanting my papers. I told her I didn't have any papers. I wrote my novels on a computer, and I didn't print out my drafts. More to the point, I didn't write in drafts. I worked on one chapter, one page, one paragraph, a single sentence, over and over again until it was right, and then I moved ahead. I made no record of any of that. I had nothing to collect. "Look again," the Librarian of Congress said to me. But I didn't want to look again. I had boxes of correspondence and dull journals that made note of what I was reading on a given day and how much I'd written and whether or not dinner turned out well. There were some old stories in the back of a file drawer that I didn't want to read. I wasn't interested in revisiting all the things I'd gotten wrong, and I was even less interested in having a stranger see it. Dead or alive, I wanted to be judged by my best work, the finished product. The librarian, whose collections had no doubt been built on tenacity, encouraged me to put off making a decision, even though I had told her my decision. She said she would circle back again. Of course, I had papers, just not the kind of papers anyone would want. Months before, while cleaning out a closet of her own, my mother had presented me with a heavy box full of short stories and letters I'd written in college and graduate school, and all the way through to the publication of my first novel. When I told her I didn't want it, she ignored me. She told me to put the box in my car. "If you're going to throw those things away, then give them back," she said the minute I picked up the box. I told her once I took it out of her house, she forfeited any say in the matter. I would have thrown the box away were it not for the fact that I took a quick look inside and saw a photograph of my grandmother right on top, 8 by 10 inches in color. My cousin Chad had taken it, such a beautiful, happy picture of her that none of us remembered. My smiling grandmother made it clear that I would, at some point, have to pick through the contents before sailing it into a dumpster so as not to lose anything this important. Still, I was a little more than annoyed that I would have to deal with things I'd never made a choice to save. Coincidentally, a few weeks later, my sister came across a similar, though smaller, stash of Anne memorabilia. My sister is someone who saves things. She'd held on to poems I'd written, stories, letters, notes on cocktail napkins. It wasn't as if I had said to my mother and my sister, "There's been interest in my papers. What do you have lying around?" The chickens were coming home to roost all by themselves. I put my mother's box and my sister's box with the giant box my stepmother had mailed me when my father died. My father was a true archivist. He'd saved everything he could find about me. 5 years later, my father's box was still sitting there unopened. Now the boxes could keep their own society. "I'm going to drive to Nashville," Damien said when he called again the next morning. "These papers are too important to put in the mail. What time can you meet me at the bookstore?" Damien knew I owned a bookstore. "Don't do this," I said. "I want to see the joy on your face when I present you with these papers." "Damien, please, there isn't going to be any joy on my face. This isn't worth your time. Just put them in the mail." "How's 1:30? He asked. I was part of a story that was writing itself. All I was being asked to do was show up. "Sure," I said, defeated. "Sure. 1:30. My deep aversion to my early work, my desire to be spared any piece of my juvenilia, comes from the belief that it wasn't good. I wondered how my teachers had given me so much encouragement and decided that they'd pushed me not because I was talented, but because I was the hardest worker. They understood. I had no backup plan. I needed to be a writer because I didn't know how to do anything else. Human beings cobble together their own mythologies over time. I was unloved. I was too loved. I was popular, a loner. Misunderstood, persecuted, stupid, a winner. We use the past to explain ourselves. As many times as I told myself that I was going to open those boxes one day, sort through and see what was in there, I never got any closer to actually doing it. It was Pandora's lesson. Don't lift the lid. Were it not for the toddler they brought with them, I would have sworn that Damien and his wife were still in high school. He had a short brush of black hair and black stud earrings. Her hair was a shade of blonde that was very nearly white and thick and pulled into a ponytail. The son, cheery and pale, favored his mother. Damien gave me my papers, gently unfolding each of the poems, saving the VFW letter for last. In return, I gave their child some books, as well as a book for his mother that I inscribed in honor of our mutual nightstand. It was a scholarship, he told me, although the letter from the VFW made no such reference. Maybe that's why you got to go to college. I got to go to college because I went to a private Catholic school. I got to go to college because my teachers encouraged me and helped me past my shortcoming, because my parents had the money to send me, because I grew up in the rarefied world where the gift of education was a given. In addition to winning an essay contest, I had won something so enormous and pervasive it could not be named. My guess was that Damien had never seen so much luck. He had driven to Nashville to give me a laurel I dropped, because who drops laurels? Who wouldn't want such a treasure returned? I remembered to thank him profusely before they headed back to Wartrace. January 8th, 1980. Dear Anne, I wish to take this opportunity to congratulate you on being chosen first place winner of the Voice of Democracy program sponsored by VFW Post 1291. I further congratulate you on being chosen second place winner for the District 6 level. I wondered, who had won first place at the District 6 level, and how had life turned out for him or her? The letter went on to inform me that the two awards would be presented at two separate dinners, and that my parents and teacher should plan on attending both events. Had that happened? The letter was so brittle and brown, it looked like it had been fished out of the back of Abraham Lincoln's nightstand. It's foxed, my friend Jenny told me when I showed it to her. Jenny had spent her professional life working in advertising in New York. Foxed was a classy way of describing age-related deterioration of paper. 40 years in the back of a nightstand was long enough to become foxed. The three poems and the notes I'd made for a forensics tournament speech were foxed unto disintegration. The photograph of the seven-member cheer squad was badly crumpled and torn, but Tavia, kneeling high up on the shoulders of Lisa Lawson, was unscathed. I looked through what Damien had given me and found that it affected me not at all. The poetry was awful, but not in any special way, just the average, awful poetry of 15. I had recently slept in my neighbor's house to be with their children while they attended a funeral out of town. The 12-year-old daughter told me the plot of a story she'd been working on for school. It's about these people who kidnap children, she said, looking through the refrigerator for whipped cream. Every week, they kill one of the children, so the ones who are left decide to escape, but then the kidnappers find them and kill them too. I don't know, though. I might not finish it. I have another idea about a girl whose brother suicides. Sweet girl. I would have wrapped her in my arms had she not been foraging. I'd be so worried about you, I said, were it not for the fact I remember writing those same stories when I was your age. She turned from the open refrigerator to beam at me. What Damien had given me, along with my award letter and terrible poetry, was insight. What was I so afraid of? If this was my early work, then I could open those boxes. All I'd needed was a warm-up, a test case. The box my mother had given me was heavy-sided and rose-covered, with metal handles, faux-foxed, to look like the stuff of memories. And how? The thick stack of stories in the bottom were buffeted by a deep, dark woods of personal correspondence, letters I'd received in the summer of 1989 while I was away at two different artist colonies, letters I'd written home, as well as all the letters that had come and I'd left those colonies. The box contained day-by-day documentation of the summer I slipped out of my brief first marriage at the age of 25, quit teaching, and moved into my mother's guest room. It was not a time I wanted an accurate record of. How had so many letters from one time come to be in one box? I'd moved home right after I left those artist colonies, my suitcase bursting with a summer's worth of mail. I dumped my prodigious correspondence into the nightstand in my mother's guest room, a nightstand which, coincidentally, was the same style as the one I'd had in high school, the same one my grandmother had downstairs. A fleet of identical nightstands had been purchased at some point in our family history. They were everywhere. When I moved home in 1989, my stepfather, Mike, had just moved out for the final time. And for a while, my mother, grandmother, and I lived together, the three of us. True to form, when more mail came, I jammed that mail into the nightstand as well. When I moved to Cape Cod many months later, I left all those letters behind. And when my mother moved again, she scooped everything out and dropped it into the box of stories she'd been keeping for me. Read more than 30 years later, the mail of 1989 amounted to a series of incorrect predictions coming from every possible direction. I want you to come to Greece. I will love you forever. I will finish this novel. It looks like I'm going to get the job. Soon you'll come home. None of those things happened. We thought we were making plans when in fact we were only guessing, and it was a crazy, reckless guessing at that, like throwing tarot cards at a dartboard while blindfolded. At every turn, we believed we were onto something big, the absolute truth of our lives. We were wrong about nearly all of it. You asked if I spent much time wondering how my life will work out. My friend Jack wrote in July of that year. He was finishing his doctorate in evolutionary biology at Stanford. Only 6 or 7 hours a day. Things like water policy, waste disposal, and road repair interest me a lot. I don't really know the best way to go about it all. Getting back into journalism, going to law school, or getting into politics. But I think that I really should do something. Of course, I still spend a lot of time fantasizing about trekking to the South Pole alone. I think that this is the major conundrum for me, whether to devote myself to public good or personal growth. I'm not sure why they seem so separate, but they do. Only my friend Lucy had it right. She wrote to me from Scotland that summer. 2 weeks ago, I saw the new Indiana Jones movie. It's amazing how easy it is to die in the movies. Blam! And that's it. In Shakespeare, you even get to announce it. I am slain. Mother, he has killed me. Romeo and Juliet and Macbeth, respectively. It would be interesting to see something like the Oxford Book of Death, which would give a complete listing of deaths in literature with subheadings for mythic, heroic, bathic, feudal, etc., etc. Literature makes too much of death, or perhaps not enough, I'm not sure. I've been thinking lately of Christ dying on the cross, and it's occurred to me how important it is that he cries out and is lonely and thirsty on the cross. No death is glorious or triumphant. And in this story of everlasting life, the obscenity of death is kept intact. I suspect this is to remind us of the holiness of the ephemeral. We're always so busy looking towards for the eternal. Lucy would manage to stay alive another 13 years. Going through those envelopes was unbearable at first, a too hot bath. But in not much time, I adjusted, then relaxed, and then wanted to get out. There were many pictures of my mother's kitten, as well as pictures of the man my mother was in love with, sitting on a beach in Israel. What was he doing in my box, along with the letters from my sister and grandmother? Who knew? The box is never the domain of just one person. Even if it was labeled as my box, we all intersected there. I picked up a short story I had written, but I couldn't make myself read it. I went downstairs to the basement with a knife to open up the box of things my father had kept. It had, after all, been waiting a very long time. Whereas my mother's box was a jumble of stories and letters, a time capsule free for all, my father's box was a meticulously curated collection of three-ring binders full of plastic sleeves, each sleeve containing publicity materials, reviews, highlighted bestseller list, magazine articles I'd published, stories I'd published, pictures of me at readings, pictures of us together at readings. My mother kept the drafts, the handwriting, the scrawl, while on the other side of the country, my father saved very little of what I had written and a great deal of what had been written about me. Together, separately, those two collections added up to something quite complete. Sitting on the floor of the basement closet, I leafed through not my writing, but my career, my first review in the New York Times, the program from England's Orange Prize ceremony. I opened the third binder and out fell the mugshots of the Manson family, Charlie and Tex, who was also Charles, Clem, who was also Grant, and Linda and Leslie and Sadie May, who was also Susan, all of them in triplicate, one shot staring straight ahead, one shot in profile, one set of pictures had my father's neat handwriting on the back, Charles Miles Manson, MC 11, 1134, 56, 130, Brown Brown, FBI number 643369A, LA number 312168M. Dad, what the hell? Why all those murderers stuck in the binder? Why are they, of all people, not confined to a plastic sleeve? My father had been the person to connect the Tate and LaBianca murders. He had been one of the first people to question Manson, and he had been in the group that went to Death Valley to find him and the family at the Barker Ranch and bring them back to Los Angeles. I remember asking my father about it when I was in high school. I said there must have been something powerful about Manson, something bewitching to have gotten so many people to follow him like that. Those people would have followed parked cars, my father said without drama or hesitation. It was just a fact. And looking at their faces now, I could see it. These were blank-eyed kids, remorseless, half laughing, having been dragged in to be charged for slaughter. That trip to Death Valley came just a couple of weeks after my mother moved my sister and me to Nashville. I shuffled the pictures back into a neat deck and brought them upstairs to my office. They didn't belong in the binder or in the box, but then again, they didn't belong anywhere. Oh, Damien, see where you've brought me? I have those too. my sister said later when I showed her the mugshots. Mine don't have Dad's writing on the back, though. You got the better set. I got the better set of Manson family mugshots? My God, do you want mine? She did not. I've always had the impulse to protect myself, but somewhere along the way I got confused about what I needed protection from. Funny enough, the short stories didn't turn out to be the problem. The reason not to go into the boxes were the letters from my first husband and the letters from my darling dead friend and the Manson family in the binder of press clippings with the magician's assistant. Those are the things that stop the day. I'd been afraid that the stories of my youth would be as bad as my youthful poetry. I'd been afraid I'd somehow been given a life I hadn't deserved. But that's ridiculous. We don't deserve anything. Not the suffering and not the golden light. It just comes. The preponderance of the stories saved came from my sophomore year of college, the fall of 1982 through the spring of 1983, when I was 18 and then 19. It was the year I studied with Alan Gerganis in the very first fiction class I ever took. I say these were the majority of the stories that were saved, but it would be more accurate to say they were the majority of the stories I wrote. Much of the work I turned in for the rest of college and all the way through graduate school were rewrites of stories I'd written for Alan. I'd intended to be a poet, but as the pages from Damien's Mother's Nightstand proved, I was bad at it. Then, in the distance breaks my wave. The poet cannot run from life, for they are life. We must stand the experience. After my freshman year of college, it was clear that in order to be a writer, I'd need to pivot. The thing about short stories is that they are themselves little boxes of the past, even if you never meant for them to be. With few exceptions, I had no memory of having written them. How could I so clearly remember the VFW essay and have practically no memory of the short stories? The answer is volume. I wrote dozens of stories. Sitting on the couch in my office, I found myself reading them with a curiosity as to how they would end. I wrote a lot that was overtly Southern that year, leaning heavily into my love of Eudora Welty and Carson McCullers. That had less to do with who I wanted to be as a writer and more to do with my own attempt to seem the smallest bit exotic in the extremely exotic world of Sarah Lawrence College in Westchester County. Lou Reed's then wife, Sylvia, was in Alan's class that year, beautifully decked out in leather everything. It was a school of actresses and models and boarding school girls who went to Switzerland to ski on winter break. I tried to distinguish myself by playing the only card I had, which was that I alone in this talented group hailed from Tennessee. Below is a page from a story I wrote called Badge. Please note, I have transcribed the original exactly, resisting the powerful temptation to edit or at least supply the bucketful of commas that are missing. What did I have against commas when I was young? He doesn't look like any of us, even though we are first blood cousins. Edith came home crying last year from art class because someone said we were all pasty faces. I think that pretty much fits. I tried to tell her that red hair is good luck. Fellas going off to the service always want to pat our heads and stuff. Everyone wants to play it down. We get pale blue sweaters for Christmas and lots of stocking caps. I, for one, have always wanted a red dress, flame red, like the neon sign at Henson's Luncheonette, or a poinsettia leaf, or a bottled cherry. A dress with long sleeves and a big full skirt that I would wear every Sunday until it was threadbare. Aunt Grace has kin from Italy or New York or somewhere, and that's where Badge got his hair. It's jet black when it's wet and almost that dark when it's dry. while the rest of us cook like French fries in the sun and have to lie still all night smeared up with Noxzema, Badge just gets this nice color, like the inside of a Heath bar. His real name is Henry, a fact only known to his truest friends. When he joined the Cub Scouts after they first moved to Memphis, he did very well, and by the time he was a year into Boy Scouts, he had earned almost every possible badge a person could earn, including cooking and kindness to animals. The other kids weren't even jealous, since he was always acting so natural with them. Everyone called him Badge since then. He doesn't like to talk about it, but once when I asked him to show them to me, he did. He keeps them in the zipper compartment of his suitcase. He took out this green felt sack that had a long green felt sash inside, the kind Miss Americas wear with the names of their states only wider. Covering the front and the back were these little patches about the size of Coke tops, and when they'd been run over, all attached in neat little rows, Aunt Grace sews very well, I asked him to put it on, but he said he didn't want to, and so he put it on me. It came all the way down past my knees. We stood for a good 10 minutes in front of a full-length mirror in the hall closet, just looking. I was a Christmas tree, covered with lights and glass balls and peppermints. Really, it was a beautiful thing. As much as I played up my Southernness by way of Southern California, plenty of the stories in the box were not remotely Southern. I had written from the point of view of women and men, boys and girls, white people, black people, Asian people. I had written stories in a floating, omniscient voice, something I found impossible to pull off when I tried it years later, forgetting completely that I already knew how to do it. Seeing those stories now was like finding out that I used to speak French and play the piano. I wouldn't have believed it, and yet, look, there I am. I marveled at the scope and bravery I found. I marveled at my willingness to fail, but mostly, I marveled at Alan Gerganis and his clean, distinctive penmanship in the margins of my work. He didn't bother with my missing punctuation or phonetic spelling. Instead, he nudged and praised and critiqued and urged me on. A, it's much better. The shape is more apparent. The voice has somehow purified itself. The brothers don't get underfoot now, and the cousin, the Boy Scout stuff is lovely, feels more erotically there. My one quibble, I think you need definitely to place the narrator on that porch and connect the speculative scene more fully to her. Otherwise, one palpably misses her and waits for her to return. Consider the last page switch to present tense. You have made a good thing better. Inside of a Heath bar, Lord, let me live there. Alan. It's difficult to explain how much it meant that Alan Gerganis palpably missed my narrator and instructed me to place her on the porch so that he would know where she was, that he ignored my more trivial errors in order to concentrate on making me stronger. Not only to make the story stronger, to make me stronger. This was the second draft of Badge that I found in the box. There were first and third drafts as well. Alan did not roll his eyes or turn away when I tried again. Instead, he pointed me in the direction I needed to go, which is to say, here, towards this present life. On the back of a story called Catching Cold, he wrote, A, the speed of this works for it. It has an immediacy related to fevers. I feel for her and poor Sam, so eager to help her. Her claustrophobia is well done, simply done. I see the old couple and Walter. Her final recovery and resolve seems laden with interesting and perverse reasons all her own, a resurrection Atlantic, C. Michael Curtis, The New Yorker, Charles McGrath, The Paris Review, Mona Simpson, Allen. What did I do with such information? Nothing, I'm sure. I wasn't writing to be published. I was writing for Allen. I wanted so much to be like him. I wanted so much for him to love me. When he was no longer my teacher, I saw a marked decline in both the quality and the quantity of my output. The evidence of this made clear by what isn't in the box. Without the easy pressure of his hand on my back, I lost my way, went into a kind of hibernation. In the years that followed, I learned less about how to write and more about how to internalize what he'd already taught me. I was a garter snake digesting a gazelle. It took time. Allen, Allen, I wrote to him in an email a few days ago. How did you manage? How were you able to give so much? It's mystifying. Forever attentive, he wrote me back in minutes. You mention our working together at Sarah Lawrence. The pleasure was all on my side. You were all for learning everything you could as soon as possible, and each lesson stayed learned. That lent a natural momentum to how much could be accomplished in quantum leaps. Gosh, I love teaching and still have dreams of getting panicky calls from Stanford and Iowa. Your class is here waiting. Sorry, hold them there. I'll catch the next plane. Our work together. That was precisely how he made me feel. No one was ever as lucky as me, except, of course, for all of his other students. We are legion. When I told Allen I might be changing my mind about giving my papers to the library instead of the fireplace, he said he too had considered pulling a Willa Cather and incinerating everything, but decided to send his papers to Duke instead. Always the overachiever and archivist, he had mailed in 52 boxes to date, 52 and counting. I think were I to scrape together every last thing I had, including this speech, I might come up with 3 boxes. Of course, without my mother and father and sister, I'd have a shoebox, though I'd held on to a few of the stories I had written in college. My mother seemingly had them all. That was because every single week I mailed her my homework. Writing goes well, read the note I attached, but at the rate of 1 story a week, I'm terrified of having a 1 week block or, God forbid, the flu. And, well, we can't deal in negatives. Aside from more work than I can possibly survive, I am one happy clam. I seem to have very up days right after the story is turned in and very nervous ones right before it's due. Subsequently, it feels like my weekends begin on Tuesday and the work starts on Friday. And then? Well, it's 3 weeks in coming, but here is the badge revision. There were a lot of questions about how Belle would know what had happened at the fair, so I'm letting her imagine it. I think it's stronger now. Let me know. P.S. Many thanks for the October funds. And then? I'm starting to feel a bit guilty about monopolizing so much of your time. I just want you to have a sense of the quantity that I'm turning out these days. And then? I thought about saving a bunch in postage and waiting until you got here to give you this one in person, but perhaps the continuity is nice. P.S. Bring envelopes. Week after week, I wrote stories, got them back, and mailed them home. Week after week, my mother read them and then put them in a box to save. She believed in my stories, and so she saved them. She loved me, and so she saved them. She knew me well enough to not let me make a decision about what would happen to them until I had passed the midpoint of my 50s. She answered all my letters when I was in college. I always had envelopes in my mailbox at school, although sometimes they were notes from a boy named Larry, whose work-study job it was to sort out the mail on the campus post office. Larry wrote to me on the days that I didn't get letters. I wish I'd saved those notes from my mother and the notes from Larry. I can't imagine what kind of work it would take to actually put the past in order, to make sense of what was there while resisting the urge to expunge and the worst of it and correct the rest. Not just my atrocious spelling, but my exhausting efforts to affect a tone that I thought of as witty and urbane. My fiction wasn't autobiographical, but the voice in those stories was much closer to who I was than the girl I tried to be in those letters. "I've been thinking a lot about great literature," I wrote to my mother. "It seems to me that the majority was banged out on a manual. What else could Hemingway have used? A 75-pound IBM Selectra? Ha! The current in Paris is hardly the current in Barcelona. As we can tell, A Farewell to Arms would not have materialized to be the book we know and love. Love? No, not yet. Not any. Not a glimmer of hope on the horizon. Just me and my Hermes, mon ami." Good Lord. I keep pens in the drawer of my nightstand now, scratch pads, a tiny book light. I've found that when some thought wakes me, writing it down is my best hope of going back to sleep. 3 o'clock in the morning isn't the time to think about the letter that needs to be written, or that the dog is out of biscuits, or that once again I dreamed of missing my flight. Sometimes, rarely, what wakes me is important. A scene from a novel I've yet to write. And this is a piece of luck so sacred that I will always be ready to meet it. What if the notes I made in the middle of the night were to fall behind the drawer of the nightstand? It could happen. When I woke up in the morning, I'd never think to look for them. Half the time, I have no memory of waking up. And what if, years from now, the circumstances of my life were to change, and I were separated from this nightstand? They're beautiful. Carl bought them as a pair long before we were married. Someone would want them. What if the person who bought them at an estate sale found the dreams and the grocery list and the few sentences that pointed towards a novel, and then went to all the trouble to track me down? Would I tell them to throw the notes away? Would I say that a dream and a grocery list and a possible idea from so many years ago meant nothing to me now, only because I was afraid to look? No. I would tell that person how I used to do that all the time, write down ideas in the middle of the night. I would say, "You're reminding me of just how much of myself I put into my nightstand. You're reminding me how lucky I was to have that nightstand there. The drawer where everything from the past was crammed turned out to contain equal measures of darkness and light, or maybe more light, because Tavia was there with the veterans who'd fought for our country in foreign wars. I wonder now how I had ever slept beside such a luminous piece of furniture. Were something like this to ever happen again, I would approach the past with considerably more tenderness. I would marvel at my youthful 57-year-old handwriting, the paper foxed at the edges. I would say, Damien, thank you. Thank you, Lucy and Jack, for writing me those letters. Thank you, Alan, for holding the lantern high. Thank you to my father and sister and grandmother for saving the parts of the story. Thank you to my mother for saving all of it, or for saving me, depending on how you read this. Thank you very much.